Well, we might make a start. Welcome, everyone. It's a great pleasure to have an evening with Robert MacPherson. Tonight we have Rob MacPherson, who is very acclaimed Australian artist, and also Rex Butler, who is Associate Professor and Reader in Art History here at the University Art Museum, the University of Queensland. And we're going to be engaging with Bob, and Bob will be talking about his works. That we have a series of images that we'll be referring to throughout the talk. The exhibition upstairs was curated by Rex Butler, and it's
with a lot of help from Michele.
And it's quite neat in that it was this exhibition is 2013, but in 1993 there was an exhibition here at the university called Robert MacPherson, A Proposition to Draw, 1973 to 1978. And we have with us Nancy Underhill, who was the curator of that exhibition. And some of the works are upstairs that are in the collection of the university. Mm-hmm. So it's very nice to have Nancy here with us this evening.
And we even have a slide of the show to show
we
you.
We do. Yeah. So we'll make a start, and maybe we can start with an image. We're actually starting with a work that's not actually by Bob. And Rex, you might like to take that.
Well, one of the things we're going to do is, because Bob really hasn't been recorded telling his life story, we thought it'd be very interesting for people just to get Bob speaking about not only the work perhaps upstairs, but the life and times of it. And one of the really interesting enigmas about Bob's career, at least for me as an outsider and someone who wasn't there at the time, is how he started making his art. Without going into all the details, because Bob will talk to us about that, Bob comes in a way from the outside of the art world and, to my eyes, approaches art as a sort of autodidact, which is very interesting. That is, he doesn't come from an art background, didn't train as a young man as an artist, did all kinds of other interesting occupations, and at least according to the story that I've read, came across in an art magazine in the State Library the work of this guy called Howard Mayring, a New York school stripe painter, a kind of colleague of Morris Luce, in an art magazine, an American art magazine in the library, and just started reading this thing kind of just out of interest, I think. I mean, he had some art background, but seeing a very modern work of art and just reading it, I guess without any preconceptions. And this kind of very advanced modernist work in Brisbane was pretty out of context. And I think the fascinating thing about Bob is that he starts to get very influenced by this kind of work and one of its leading theoreticians and art critic called Clement Greenberg. But to my mind, and I might be wrong, taking it without any kind of a context, he can sort of read the words in a strange, different, new way. And in a really unusual way, and at least in Australia at the time, starts making, I guess, high modernist American style art in the middle of Brisbane sometime, I don't know, Bob, what are we talking like, the late 60s or something, even earlier?
I believe I was always an artist. So there's a photo of me somewhere there as a 2.5-year-old child with a pencil and pad in my hand. And that was 1939, so there were transient photographers that travelled to the country and came on the train. And there were flyers put out, Joe Blow will be at such and such with his big plate camera. And so the only way they could ever keep me quiet was to give me a pencil and paper. So the only way they could, so that's a photograph of me drawing him. He's photographing me. So, and I believe that in what I call an art intellect, that we're born with that. That's a big help if you have that. It's a different way of thinking. It's a form of voyeurism in a way. You always need visual sort of input of some kind or other. And then you become a flaneur in later life, sticky beaking and watching. So with the thing, when I was 17 or 18, my other skills were disappearing fast, so I was left with that one skill, and I thought I'd better do something with it. So I still thought that art was about drawing and painting. So I went to Oxlade's, who was still there, but Brian Oxlade, I think, was the grandson, very nice man. And he gave me a little couple of Winter and Newton handbooks on oil painting. He wanted to sell me the stuff, but I wasn't so cynical then. So he sold me oil paint. There was no acrylics as we know them then. So in this little handbook, one of the little handbooks, was a little essay on Rembrandt and what a great revolutionary he was, you know, that he altered just one simple thing of process. So rather than, I'm not sure of the order, but previously it was, if you wanted a good red, you would glaze a red over a brown, or a brown over a red, I'm not sure. But what he did, he reversed that process. So within the steps or the evolution of oil painting, he was a great revolutionary. And he also used a pig bristle, or like a filbert, a blunt pig bristle brush. Previous to that, it had all been sable and stuff like that. So that gave him a very distinctive mark. So that also gives the pig, the humble pig, a very, very important part in the pantheon of art making. So in these little books, so I tried then to follow the table of elasticity, which took, you know, I couldn't wait 10 years for the paint to dry or the first coat to dry or whatever. I didn't have a lot of little assistants like the great masters running around the place. So I started to paint. So previously, being a good Catholic boy, I thought that was a really, to think that I could capture that out there or this in there on a few centimetres or few inches of canvas, I thought that was disingenuous and, you know, very vanity-driven thing to do. So to paint the figure, I lost, that didn't engage me intellectually. To paint landscape didn't engage me intellectually because of those reasons. I was then left with the process of painting. So from a young child, you know, having the Catholic thing and being exposed to the good Renaissance reproductions in Always Jesus and Mary, in the missionary calendars, I never saw those as Jesus or Jesus and Mary. I always saw that as an object, a man-made object that someone made. And I would, you know, having an analytic mind and being a little pest, I always thought, you know, who told them that was Jesus? They've never seen Jesus. Or how do they know that's Mary? They've never seen Mary. So I still have that line of thought. So I went through all those processes from, and I saw when I did Nash Ochoco thing, 1956, I was a year late, I went to the local dentist. So the only place you would ever see Geographic magazines, Saturday Evening Post or Life magazine, would be in a doctor's or a dentist's waiting room, in Brisbane anyway, I don't know where else. And there was the photographs, the quite famous photographs of Namuth, I think, of Pollock and Krasner. So, and that really, you know, that knocked me more than having my teeth drilled, I think, maybe. So I was quite taken with that art could be this strange thing. And these people were proto-hippies, you know, before there was what's name. So, you know, there are these important steps. So I worked through abstraction. I got into the old tech in those days on portfolio. They waved the educational whatevers, which I was more or less devoid of, but they allowed me in on portfolio, and I can't remember what it was, but they...
How old were you when you re-entered, as it were, tech, Bob?
When I went there, I was about 22 or 23, and I thought that they had some sort of mysterious secretive, a drying agent that would make oil paint dry faster. Mm-hmm. So I was only there, but it was so... The only other students at the time were a gaggle of young girls who I think their parents probably shunted them in there for. So it turned out to be a commercial art class. So on the orientation day, you know, each of these people, the fellow that taught perspective, and I won't use his name, is still around, a fellow called Charlie Rowlands, who was a lovely old man, a fellow called Reed, who has... Well, I hope he's not here. I don't think he'd probably be 180. So each of these people got up and gave their spiels. So this fellow got up, this is this landscape painter, got up and banged the desk. All the young girls jumped. And he said, if there's anyone in this class who is interested in art, for arts, I'd say, get out. He summed me up in one. So I was only there for a week or so, and I realised that it had nothing to do with what I was interested in at all, because by that time I was an abstractionist, following Barnett Newman and people like that. So,
I mean, it's really interesting, Bob, because, you know, you're interested in this kind of faraway art in a way, you know, yeah. But in a way... you're interested from a very procedural sort of rulemaking aspect. In other words, you know, you're very abstract relationship to it. You're setting, trying to find a set of rules to make art.
What the theory had been waiting for me all my life. Mm. Painting, you know, the thing is, how do they know this is Jesus? You know, someone made that thing. That's a thing hanging on the wall. So on the wall. So, you know, this thing of painting as an object, which became sort of like late 50s, early 60s, became very much a thing in terms of art theory, which I was following before Greenberg. So that theory was waiting for me. You know, it fitted with my intellect. I'd never thought other about it. So I was always looking for the perfect scale. So one of the things, the dictums of colour field theory of Greenberg's was that you needed a personal container to really simplify. Forget about all the essays on Kitsch and all that other, you know, proto-Marxism. I was living that as a militant unionist. So they... One of the things that... It was a recipe for making good art. Was like a bit of quality control. So simplifying it down was to find a personal container to do two or three or more colour juxtapositions. So I was always looking for the personal container. Mm-hmm. I'd been travelling a bit. I'd always looked at art in an analytic way. And one of the ways that I felt it always fell down, or most often fell down, was poor format choice. Poor rectangle choice. So, you know, a lot of them are long, skinny rectangles which were formed, they were for pier mirrors that hung, or long sort of rectangular pictures that hung about above the fireplace.
Can we show one of the hand rituals from Nancy's show, which I think is what you're talking about? Maybe the long series from this show from 1993, from the UAR, the old UAM, as it were. Keep on going. That would be probably a relatively good instance. The ones on the right, Bob, of what you're talking about. These kind of gestures that fill the space and try to declare the space of the work, right? To try and make sense between the gesture and the scale.
No, it really wasn't. It wasn't sort of... What that was, to come forward for Mehring, I had a hire to stand, life intruded, I took on certain responsibilities. Well, it wasn't my oeuvre at that stage, but, you know, my body of work at that time was pulled off the stretchers and whatever because of economic necessity. So I painted then from pretty heavily. I gave up work, I'd saved my money from about 62 to 67, 68 or something. And then this other thing, life intruded. So I was still fiddling around looking for that perfect shape. And so I was fiddling around with the Plato's idea on rectangle and the golden mean and all that stuff. So I got, because I was then, through that period, I was working on the docks as a painter and docker. And then I worked for an oil company as a loader, also, you know, bunkering ships and doing all sorts. So I had another 6 years then in the port. But just by things that happen in your life, I got myself off to Holland. You know, I could see the real stuff there. And there was a group called the Knoll Group that you know, I was staying in Utrecht at the time. So at the Central Museum in Utrecht, there was an exhibition of the Knoll Group. And I thought, you know, my thinking and what I've done is better than this. So, and that's where I saw my first Newman in the flesh, that wonderful Who's Afraid of Red, Yellow and Blue, whatever order. I saw my first Ryman there, who what's name mentions, which I thought was retardé, you know, because it had a colour, a coloured underpainting. And I was such a hot gospeler, I thought that was a cop-out to lean on that. So I went, when I was in Utrecht, they also had there a university museum, and they'd specialised in the 30s very seriously in the science of the paranormal. So they had all sorts of machines and stuff like that to conjure up ghosts, if you will, probably to give them a bit of research money. And there was a bit of, much in advance of the Ouija board, you know, but what they also had there was a series of pre-Napoleonic measuring devices. So when, I'm being pedantic here, but when Napoleon came through Northern Europe, he introduced a positive set of weights and measures. But amongst those devices, there was a set of coffer makers' foot rules. So a coffer maker that in the development of the chest of drawers, there were cassonis and then five-plank coffers. And they always looked to me, because I was an antiques dealer here, I collected elementary bush furniture, which was adzed furniture, it always looked right. And English early antiques, which I also dealt in, they always had a look of rightness about them. So all these foot rules were all a different length. So they were the lengths of the coffer maker's foot. So all the coffers and all the furniture, everything was made, was human scaled, because it became directly from the maker's foot. So when I came back to Australia after a few months, I realised that to get that perfect rectangle to do my sort of Howard Merring within, that I put marks on the wall with a 4-inch brush as high as I could reach vertically, as far as I could reach horizontally from one edge. Then I measured those, so I made these rectangles up, which were absolutely spot on in terms of scale and size. You know, there was the Lee Caboo thing, the same thing. Da Vinci did the same thing, this thing of body scale. Rex mentions in his essay in the catalogue for the show, Stresemensky. So I was fortunate when I was in Holland to go to the Kroller Museum in Utrecht, not in Utrecht, I'm just trying to think of where that was. I don't have my notes. But anyway, at Arnhem. So this was a very beautiful museum in a park. You couldn't drive in there, you had to walk 3 kilometres into the place. So they had an exhibition of Stresemensky's, probably the first one. So he was going through all that process of paint application and whatever, constructivist, the primitivism, a theory which I don't buy. I don't want to beg art with those difficulties. So, but his paint application, everything was marvellous, and he worked through that, but all the rectangles were wrong, mm-hmm. because they were still Victorian rectangles. So when I came home, I started to do that.
Is that when you'd count your first mature works after this visit?
No, I think my sort of was 2.5 years of age, I think, was my first mature. I fiddled around, and I spent a lot of money to do what I did. I saved enough money, I think, to buy a house at that time, but I decided that... So I just thought I gave up work for 2 years. Mm-hmm. The other thing where I got, you know, my art knowledge is based on erudition. Because in Brisbane there was at the old public library, there was a Carnegie bequest there. Mm-hmm. There seems to be some sort of ambiguity mm-hmm. about this. So I worked in those days from 1955 to 1958, I worked in the sugar industry as a loco fireman on those puffinbillies, and I cut a bit of cane. And I would, that was 3, 4, 5 months a year, so I'd get a good roll together. And I would go up to that library and sit up there with all the old stiffs with their glass and bags in those days and whatever, nodding off. And I worked through like a job. And whoever the librarian was that was buying that stuff, there was sort of very up-to-the-minute books there. I could tell the other artists, I could spot who'd been there, like Fulbrook, for instance. Molvig had been up there. Blackman had stuck his nose in there. Dickerson had stuck his nose in there. And you could get away with that stuff.
But you're just so different from those artists, Bob, right? I mean, that's the interesting thing to me. You're just... completely uninterested in national art. You're just reading this stuff in a very unmediated way, like an alien or something, and going, I can make work completely untroubled by the fact you're so far away. And I find that
because
extremely interesting.
Yeah, because the thing is that if you realise that, you know, the strata of society, you know, and Brisbane being the type of society it was then, it was sort of... having also been in the antiques trade and being, you know, the original collector of the Harvey School pots and all that stuff, the collection of that now of mine is in the in the National Gallery in Canberra. I realised I was always interested in the economic source. So a lot of those people, those women who were, I hope there's no grandparents here or grandchildren, they really had, you know, the feminist art thing that arrived probably in this country 3 years after it arrived in America or whatever. Women artists really had it by the balls here. They were, you know, every little sort of gallery that opened, public gallery or whatever. So some of the battles with the development of the IMA were about those things. So that was their economic source. You know, they were married well or whatever. So I was totally outside that. So there's a thing in Australian society, I see some older faces here. within my milieu, being an Australian male that went into the workforce in 1950 amongst returned soldiers and whatever that was still being demobbed up in the 70s, 47, 70. So that they were really tough people. They were taking no rubbish from anyone. But a lot of those people, there was this thing of taking the odds. If something was easy, it didn't have the value of something which was difficult. So if you were taking the odds, so I was imbued with that stuff. So, I mean, if art had been easy, I wouldn't have done it. It wouldn't have had value. And the fact that I did it here, within that society, I wasn't a part of anything. I wasn't a joiner. I carried no sort of societal value. I didn't want to look like that. It was completely, I was free of a normal, or, you know, as much as one could ever be, of a middle class. I didn't have middle class values. I had no ambition to succeed within the terms of the system. So it was really taking the odds. I just wasn't interested in, and I'd always been looking, you know, there was, you know, it's funny, like Brisbane, it's dried up in a sense. I mean, the Courier Mail always had, in the Courier Mail building, they always had their little gallery. The Telegraph, what's them, they always had their little gallery. There was always those little dribs and drabs around the city, but which have largely disappeared to a degree. It was a different time.
Now, Bob, you mentioned seeing some of the American art in Europe, but what about the big exhibitions that came out to Australia?
I travelled to Sydney for that one. Where was it? Somewhere, the first of those. I think it was about 1960.
The contemporary American paintings in 64?
I got myself off to Sydney for that. It didn't come up here.
The American art, paintings. Yeah. Mm.
There was one that came up here also, but I just can't think of...
Some recent American art? Yeah. I don't think that's...
The only thing of the only chance was that was... The one that came to Sydney didn't travel to here. There was another one came to Brisbane. There was the Duchamp show that came here to the old gallery. There was the other show, I'm just trying to think of, that had people like me in it, Americans like me. So when was that? May have been 74, 75, 76, somewhere in there.
But and Clement Greenberg, when he came to Brisbane, did you go see him?
No, I wouldn't want to see him. I found, I've never liked art as much.
Critics, yeah.
I don't, no, critics have been good for me. I've had, you know, Gertie Langer was wonderful to me and she thought I was, you know, very naughty, but I wasn't frightened of her, so she gave me a good spin. But I've always taken the odds. If someone wrote, you know, something that was really trenchant about me, I would either take from that and do something with that. I would never, you know, I wouldn't be defeated by the words of someone that I didn't respect. I would consider that scholastically, they didn't cut the mustard. Mm-hmm. You know, they hadn't done the work that I'd done. My expectation was that if I could do that, because they had the piece of paper, they should be able to do it a lot better. But, you know, because of the art intellect, that doesn't always happen.
I mean, we might start looking at the work, but one of the really interesting, maybe we start with one of the hand ritual ones up the top, which is actually in the gate. I just want to set the scene a little bit. What's fascinating to me, Bob, is, you know, you're reading, let's say, Greenberg, or you're looking at contemporary then American art, and what you're getting from it is not style, not the sort of social context, but you get from it a series of rules for making art. Yeah. And what you're interested in the work is that it apparently is made by following a series of rules, you know, to play out the work. Now, in a way, that's slightly a misreading of Greenberg, but that's neither here nor there. It's a very creative one.
I think that, you know, I've yet to meet anyone that has a correct reading of Greenberg. the same. Everyone quotes Duchamp,
mm-hmm.
but you know, no one can place themselves into that sort of mm-hmm. that the political situation in first, second generation of the 20th century. You know, no one can watch that. They weren't there.
Well, so, I mean, that's okay. But I find that interesting. Yes. You're reading it and getting a series of rules for making art because A, not that many artists are reading an art theorist to sort of generate work, and B, in a way, many American artists are doing exactly the same thing. The minimalists, in some ways, are reading Greenberg and trying to deduce a series of rules.
Yeah.
But that's fascinating to me.
But were you following the rules or bending the rules?
Every see, look, I always say that I'm a follower. I'm a follower of Greenberg. But you know, I refer to myself as Greenberg's naughty boy.
I'd agree with that. Yes.
I'm sitting in a wet paper bag, which is Greenberg's theory. And I'm sitting in there and I'm poking at it,
mm-hmm.
not wanting to break it.
I mean, I think we'll talk about how that comes to play out in your work, if you like.
So let's run through a couple and you can explain. We're ahead of ourselves with that.
Oh, well, is this all right, though? Look at this one.
Can you maybe explain the process?
With the drawings, when I came back from Europe and driven by a bit of vanity maybe at the time, I thought what I'd seen over there that, you know, I was certainly not, tried to say this with some degree of modesty anyway, that I belonged there, not here. I belonged amongst that stuff. So when I came back, I was trying to because I had a facility to draw, so what I was trying to do was to break down that facility and make drawings with a pencil, which were simply pencil drawings. And with Australian artists, there's only been one or two that I've been influenced by, and one was Godfrey Miller.
We might show a pencil drawing, Bob, that one where you just do lines down the page, if you like.
So what I was trying to do was break down facility and sort of organise. I realised that I was setting up rituals to do these drawings. So the first group of them were just, with a felt pen, were just lines.
We have that. Keep on going. More. Keep on going. That one. I'll go back. Something like that.
They come later.
Yeah, it comes later, but it's a similar sort of look. Yeah.
So that's what I was trying to do. But I found that, you know, that with drawing, the elusive line drawing, which I loved, and that there were certain things that happened there with drawing that was a bit like boxing in a way, that you had, you know, a dart onto the page. You had, you know, you had to be balanced. There was a degree of breathing. So I found that I just couldn't make a flat mark like that. I had some of the old drawing principles came back in, like Zen, if you will, that I couldn't eliminate it, because what I was doing, I was setting up the skill of de-skilling.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the mystification of demystification. So I did thousands of those drawings. So they came later.
Mm-hmm. So, Bob, you know, what you're saying is you're trying to make these kind of non-aesthetic drawings, but they're turning out always to be quite aesthetic.
Could never.
What starts to happen when you realise that problem in your work? Do you abandon it or you start playing on it? Or what?
Well, I think with the later, you know, the things that I'm currently doing, which are still... You know, I think that, you know, you can be a sort of monochromatic painter, you can be this and you can be that. If you're a painter, I don't think I am, but if you're a painter, it's so art theory based. So if you're a painter, I believed if you're going to imbue the work with presence, in the simplest terms, you know, in felt space, there's a space that we sit in, the space between the work and if you walk into a room that's going to say, hey, you know, I'm something. You may know what I may not know what I am, and you may think it's rubbish, but I'm something. So it's gained a response from you. So So I believe that, you know, that you have to have a sound, formal reason for doing something. I couldn't just sit there and do something spontaneously like an abstract expressionist or something. That has to be structured by theory. And I believe that if the theory is sound enough within the terms of art history and what's gone before, the pantheon that I speak of, that it's just flaccid and fall off the wall, to use, I think it's Clark or Reed that used that term. So, you know, I could go on and on about the what's name of icon painting, the addition of reaches and stuff to give this a certain presence. So I've always, my work is always bound in theory.
Mm-hmm. But the interesting thing is the work always exceeds the theory that generates it. That's your point,
yes,
right?
Yes, it is.
It produces something a little unexpected.
I think you quote one of my earliest statements was published or something, you know. I can't remember, I can't quote it verbatim, but where I said, things happen in process and are left, I'm surprised. Mm. So there's always that little bit of democracy in there. That sort of, if it slips outside, if there's that bit of slippage, that's absolutely fine, and I'm surprised, you know. Where Greenberg said, you know, with that colour field theory was to, you know, was pretty dumb in a way, this thing of two-dimensionality and holding the plane. You can never, I've worked through that, you can never, you know, if you make a mark on the wall with a pencil, that mark is measurable. And effectively, it is a bas relief.
Mm-hmm.
So if you incise the mark into the wall, that brings, becomes landscape space, and it's recessed into the wall, it pulls the wall onto the plane. You can't, you know, if you work through this stuff,
mm-hmm.
you can't, which is my game, you can never eliminate certain things. You get back to that same thing. So one of the things that Greenberg said was that the work had no what's name of the hand.
Mm-hmm.
So the work had to be totally free of nostalgia, narrative, emotion, sentiment, or whatever. It just had to be that thing, that flat thing holding the plane. But it's never, because it's always, if you hang an unstretched canvas on the, it is still three-dimensional. You can't get rid of that. Freed at some stage, I can't think what it was or when I read it, but Freed further defined that, where Freed said, I think it was to do with Kenneth Noland, I think, where he spoke. So Kenneth Noland did those very, very geometric, large rhomboids, mm-hmm. chevron shapes, I should say, targets and whatever. But where one contour, one area of paint met the other, like the Australian field painters, or so-called, were masking their areas, so they got no bleed
mm-hmm.
from one area to another. So Freed remarked on how paintly Noland was, because he had this halitation of edge,
mm-hmm.
this slight mm-hmm. bleed from what's name. So, you know, the Australian field painters, they misinterpreted that. But again, I mean, that was a contradiction in terms of Greenberg's theory, because you did get this very paintly thing. In fact, when Noland came out here, Noland was very good to me. He came up to Brisbane in the early days of the IMA, and he came to where I was working there then, and I was working on those big black and white series. And he said to me, which was, I didn't need the pat on the back, but I'll always take it.
Mm.
So he said, you know, you are such a good painter. Your work is much more paintly. We don't see that in America, you know. Mm. I can't help you. I can't tell you anything. I am surprised by your work. He said, the only thing I can tell you is I had the room where I was working lit with a Philips system of lighting, which was developed for Australia for wool classing. So it was a, and he said, you know, that light is too white. You should buy a yellow fluoro and pull it down. So that's, but you know, so that was that. Noland supported my work, and the only information he could give me was to alter my lighting. So,
shall we have a look at these Sarah's murals, maybe, Bob? Yeah. Which are these kind of paintings about gesture in some way?
What? Yeah. Several.
Well, what, with the murals, the murals came.
Well, should we try and describe? Yeah. Would you like to just describe to them?
Yeah, I will describe them. Yeah. So the murals, there was a thing, you know, because of my erudition art-wise and reading a lot of material all the time, through first generation, second generation abstract expressionism, a lot of the stuff I was reading, a lot of the criticism, was they met the same with, you know, I digress and I'll shut up. So what the critics quite often commented on was the spontaneity and the incident. So, you know, that's a bit of paint splatter here and there and stuff like that. So I thought with these murals, the 12-inch format came, that scale comes from three horizontal strokes with a 4-inch brush and three vertically. So that gives you a multiple of a 4-inch brush. So that has to be right. So it's then, it's the scale of the 4-inch brush that I used to paint those. So the top panel is the only panel that's painted on. So I painted that, you know, in certain permutations of black and white, so that there was such an excess of paint on the top panel, it would run down the wall onto the next panel, onto the next panel, onto the next, like a waterfall. There is some photos of my workplace somewhere. So the sixth panel was sitting on the floor. So that got, you know, that got a different type of incident. So what I did, which comes straight out of art criticism, I made the image, the image on that is just incident. It's also was sort also predicated, I was also a dealer in Chinese ceramics, Japanese ceramics, and Southeast Asian ceramics. And there was a type, there's a vase upstairs which is enlightened, I must say, to put that out. It's a Song de Boer vase. And there are degrees of qualities with them. That was because that was a very sort of fluid glaze. So to control the glaze, to get an even colour, copper red it was, to get a, so they would alter the dynamics of the vase to give the flow, once it went into the kiln, to give it traction. Mm-hmm. So the best of them have these, they have bosses around the neck, so where it flows onto the slows down. The dynamic of the shape was had to be exact, and they had a false foot, mm-hmm. you know, so that that would run under there. So where that sat in the kiln, it wouldn't run down. So the more less sophisticated of them, that would run down, and they would have to break them off and grind the base. But the most sophisticated of them were so beautifully shaped, mm. with the bosses round the neck, so that they would get pretty much even colour. It would flow down round the foot and under and stop.
But if we go back to the Sarah's Mills, I mean, it's interesting you're very evocative about the vase, because these seem to me, because you've got these kind of gaps between the panels, and you know, a kind of analysis of gesture rather than just playing out the gesture directly.
But it's, you know, it's, yeah, so the
so
thing
is sort of a sort of language of some kind enters the gesture.
It's a learning process, enters, because if you sort of, you paint all that way, you're going to get all that flow that way. Or if you paint all that way, you've got, so to balance that out, to get to control that to some degree, you have to paint that way or paint that way or paint in the centre or something. There's, you know, there is a certain level of control and there's a learning process with it. So when I'd had enough of those, I stopped. And I always thought there was a career in those for someone else, but they never took it. But there are American painters, painters contemporary now that do exactly that.
But given you've got a kind of distance towards emotion in art and you're a very analytical artist, you know, a very obvious reading of this is somehow it's a critique of the idea of spontaneity in art in some way, and that the gesture is the sort of autobiographical mark of the artist. Do you feel that that's
not at all. I think that that burdens art with...
Do you think that works, making this point about gesture?
One of my published statements, I think, yeah, but I think it's probably a satirical...
Right, what's yes, name that'll be can, fine, yes. You know, yeah.
That's, you know, I'm having a go. I think there's somewhere, there's a... just trying to think with, I think with Peter Anderson or something, where he tries to get into that sort of psychological aspect. I'm not interested in the whys of art. That's for someone else to work out. You know, there's much written on that and probably all of it's incorrect because it deals with intangibles. You know, my other thought about that is that I shovel all those questions. If those questions intrude, you know, why am I doing this? Why do I want to do this? And it gets outside that tough practice. I just shovel that over my shoulder. That comes out of the whole thing. It's not...
We're thinking about, you know, that type of expressionism. I don't know if you mentioned before when we were looking at the drawings that the ones with the pencils, you were actually hitting them with a mallet, or yes. The ones with the charcoal, you were hitting it with a ball
because
pin.
That's well in advance of the earlier simple. I was trying to get. I think my first show, was in a group show, maybe at Rayu's 73. And there's a series of works which I still have there, which are one of the beautiful draftsmen is Sorrow. You know, the pointillist. Mm-hmm. So, and he is Conte de Paris crayons. They're like a hard, they're not a crayon, they're like a hard pastel. So I looked at those things and I was sort of influenced by him quite heavily because I loved it. I loved his drawings. But so what I did with those was a series, they came black and white and red, which I didn't use. I used the black and white. So I did a series, I just stuck them, as they came out of the box, I stuck them onto the page and in all the possible permutations. Cost a lot of money.
It's in that catalogue, by the way. Nancy's camera, you can hold that up to people, yeah.
In this catalogue?
I'll find it for people, yeah.
To a limit, you know. So I was drawing with them in effect. That's right, yeah. So out of the... So that was another image. So they were drawn but not drawn.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a few.
Mm-hmm.
So these other things, what I was trying to do was to get the sum of the inherent images that were possible with the traditional what's names, a pen, mm-hmm. pencil, charcoal.
Mm-hmm.
So I worked through that, you know, overlaying them, I think. Some of the vertical ones, and I did lots of things with them. So in advance, probably about 4 years later of the Sorrow thing, that ricochet grid, that's done with a box of charcoal sticks. So it came 10 to the box. So the first drawing was drawn with, was on a concrete base. I would throw one stick on it and I would hit it with a ball peen hammer. So anyone that's in engineering knows what a ball peen hammer is. It's an awkward bloody hammer that has a flat end, but it has a rounded end. So you can't ever get a good smash with it. So what I would do was hit that one. So anything that spilt off the paper, they were imperial-sized sheets, so they're quite big. That would just become the detritus. I would leave that. And I would chase that round until I sort of pulverised it so that there was no large lumps to be pulverised. So the first one, then the second drawing would have two sticks. Bang, 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 bang. Three sticks, bang, 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 bang. Up to 10 sticks. So it took a lot more, it took 10 boxes or something to do that, but it was still 10 sticks. I then spray that with a fixative, naturally enough. So the others that we showed, so that's, I think, probably the final. So the paper by the end was quite tortured. So the white spots in the paper are actually holes. That's a secondary image that came in. So that they were all the pencils. They were 2B, which was a bit hard, 2B pencils that I could hold in my hand. And of course, I didn't tie them or do something. They would splay. And I had like a carpenter's mallet. And the others were done on the ground, so these were done there. So the another thing that I used is I always was eschewing compositional devices, so I use what I call non-compositional devices, some quality of the page or something like that. So where I stood with that, I would hit them like that, but I had to move them a bit, so some would break, some would, and I would hit them. It was just like, funnily enough, like the stuff that happens in landscape with the tree breaking. And so, you know, they have the bit of landscape image about them that I don't want.
And your sort of point about these, Bob, is you're producing them kind of by process or in some ways arbitrarily, and yet you're thinking they will always look facility-ridden, as you say. They'll look adjusted to the page. They'll look like drawings, right? That's your kind of point. They'll turn into something that looks like art again.
Yeah. Well, you can't get away from that. The thing is that also that I've used with a lot of the, like those long vertical, what's them? I've used, you know, I can't tell you who he was, but one of the noted sort of Zen masters said that if you say you're Zen, you're not Zen. So I use a lot of Zen principles, but it's not Zen, because I realise that you can't just make a flat, if you have my intent, you can't have just a flat, uninflected mark. You can't, you know, that's very, very different. You know, anyone that's a non-artist here can probably do it. When I was a colour field painter, I was painting and docking through probably 63, 68. And at Cancross at the big dock, with those big roll-on, roll-off vessels, some of the big tankers, they're flat-bottomed. So they're up in the dock, it's pumped out, and there's sort of like a couple of hundred men, you know, with these things sitting underneath with a tray and a big double roller with this anti-fouling.
We might go to the skeleton tool, which is a kind of work people think about based on your experience doing these boats, Bob, with ships. It's there, something like that.
But I was a painter before I did that, but I would go home from there where there'd be all this incident, everyone would be covered in it. You know, I'd see painters and dockers that had been on the job with me 6 weeks later and they still have a bit of paint on their ear or something like that. So this paint would, because you had to put it on and load it over an uneven surface, so this paint would come down. It was very beautiful. It was red, but when it hit the ground, it was silver. So everyone was covered in this stuff. So I used to wonder how I could take that from there and go home and do my little homage to Greenberg. how I could control that. Or I could cut a plimsoll line up along a vessel with a double roller on a 20-foot arm. You know, how could I come home and do that? So, and now, you know, I've done some really crappy jobs in my day, I can tell you, but I always arted it up. Hmm. Art was, to me, that was the one area of life where I had a bit of autonomy, and it was, so, you know, it was that other thing that I did that made that thing that I did for money tolerable.
Mm. You've talked about different sorts of aesthetics.
Yes.
Like the horse aesthetic and so on.
Yes, and Nietzsche said that art makes life tolerable. So, in my case, it does, yeah.
It's funny because your art is, in fact, an attempt to destroy art, right? That's the paradox. You're trying to produce these non-aesthetic objects in your art, in a funny, or procedurally based objects that take and choice and taste away from it.
What I've always say that, you know, this is the least... If I imbue this with intent, if you do it and your intent's not a non-art intent, it's a different intent. So that, you know, and when you've been doing it for a long time, your intent is then supported by your critical support structure, you know, the people that like you and think it's okay and all that stuff. So, you know, there's lots of difficulties in that, but my main, what's name, my need is to do that. So I have to, you know, I see that it's one system which I've extended and extended and extended. Mm-hmm. And no matter how diverse the work looks, it's still, to me, that same system that I keep pushing.
We might just look at one scarf and then we might go to the Sabco brush, perhaps. And
yeah, I'd actually like it if we could also talk about the Swanborough.
Yeah, okay, well, we could go back.
If we can go back.
Which is the one in the show.
Yeah.
I think there's even one before that, is it?
That was Nancy purchased that, in fact.
And then if you go to the next, that's Nancy, upstairs.
Nancy was very game.
Go to the next one.
She purchased that. But there was another one in advance of that.
So this is Swanborough too.
So but Nancy, there was another one of those which, you know, in all what's name you couldn't have purchased at that time for this institution. There was so with the Swanborough, when that's installed formally, like it is upstairs, it's swung, so like so. So the clues to those that know about the incident and stuff, so the clues to that of whether white went on first or the black went over the white or the white is held in the incident. That's like the first part is the coda and this is the description. So there was another one in advance of that that John Stringer bought for himself, God bless him, which was difficult, more difficult than that because of the primary panels, I painted them out black when I was finished. So the only clue to what had gone on under the black was in that, the way the incident sat. Whether it was under, over.
What's interesting about that to me is, you know, given the Sarah's Mules, where there's a tiny gap between the gestures that would otherwise be continuous, that is the gap between the two panels, but there's still a kind of a clear visual relationship. This is a much more cryptic and distant relationship between the thing and then the incident based on the thing, right? There's a much wider distance, right?
Yes, that's right.
True, but it's very hard to really...
I always used, you know, because I've sort of traversed a lot of experience in my day. I was at one stage when I was about 15, I was working on a property way the hell. I don't know what the hell I was doing there or how my parents allowed a little kid to do it. But anyway, I did it and I was convinced them, obviously. So I was working with an old fellow who was 68 or something in those days. So, I mean, that was ancient to me. I've surpassed him. So Well, what we were doing, we were building coaches around watering troughs. And so the only tools we had was a cross-cut saw, four axes, two short-handled axes, which were for ring barking, two shovels, two crowbars, an auger for drilling holes. He had no watch. He would say, oh, it's time for smoko by the sun. We never worked when it was overcast. That's a lie. So it was all done by hand. So he had on the shovels, he had notches cut. So say if a strainer post, that's the big post, that was 18 inches or something, there'd be a mark on the shovel. So you crowbar, crowbar, shovel, shovel, shovel. And when you got down to that mark, you'd know that was the depth of the hole. So you didn't have to, you know, keep measuring that stuff. He didn't even have a rule. In fact, he had a plumb bob and a string. So I learned. So a lot of the things that I've applied with installation, I'm a pioneer in this country of multiple panel installation, which is everywhere now, or the thing which they call a salon hang, which was me breaking away from that very formal thing. So I always used, I did all my own installation in those days. So I had, like a template would be a matchbox. So when you're installing, instead of measuring that what's name all the time, and I still had string lines and stuff that they don't use now. They have lasers, these magic things. So I always use that. And I saw where Ray used or something was what's name, and the secret of the matchbox which he invented. So I have a wide experience that can't be duplicated because all those things are finished. But I've always been able to apply them to my art. I speak about this other, and I got into one of the things I was doing, 93, I think it was, with Rex, with a group of students here, and I speak about a horse aesthetic, or the aesthetic of the shovel, like some people, if they're turning loam, you know, they get it everywhere, but others do it with economy of means and in such an efficient way. And I just think, within the terms of that activity, they're intellectuals of that thing. They're receipts of the shovel.
We could show scale from the tool, which I think maybe makes the point about the economy of covering a surface with a single stroke of paint in a way. If we go back just, that would be your sort of thought, wouldn't it, Bob, with these things? There's sort of the beauty of the sort of simplest mark and the many, many different ways you can actually cover a piece of canvas with one stroke of a loaded brush.
It's the other way around. So what I did with that, again, to get that scale, I realised, you know, using the brush and that, you know, that with a 4-inch brush or any brush, but a 4-inch brush in this case, that it has three inherent marks. It has, you know, the broad, the flat of the brush. It has a cutting end stroke. Anyone that's ever painted, you know, you load it up a bit and you're safe along that edge. So that's a cutting end stroke, which is the side. And then if you tip the blade, that's the point of it. So I did that on the wall, and somewhere in those photos, you can see where I did that on the wall. It's, I made a mark on the wall with the brush, and then I marked that. And I made the three marks, which are a code, a point, side. And then I had a fellow make up the stretches for me. And then I had to do my Zen thing to be able to do that.
I'm interested that you keep coming back to the Zen thing.
Well, you can't get away from certain... So the things that I've latterly done that I don't think there's any are the Mayfair group. And what they are, they're Yeah, so these Mayfair group.
And the next one.
Yeah, no, you don't see it so much. Thorley, our wonderful Lord Mayor of that time, demonised those hand-painted wonderful signs that you would see. You know, people were fined for having them, you know, and they had a patrol that went around sort of snatching them and destroying them. And, you know, there's always a peasant somewhere. So I realised that those people, those writers, I call them, that did those signs, you know, they're disappearing. But if you go up the Toowoomba Road there, the Warrego Highway, there's still some of those signs about. And I realised that they were done on, generally on Masonite or whatever it was about. They were knocked about. They kept reusing them all the time. So there's things within painting method. You know, traditional painting, going back to Rembrandt or anyone you like. So there's a thing called impasto, which is, you know, thick paint. And, you know, there's a modern, 60s jargon of low and high paintly build, which is just impasto. There's scumbling, which is, dragging a loaded brush of dry pigment or dry over a heavily textured ground, which gives you this scumbled mark, which is beautiful. And there's that thing of glazing. So these people, by just unselfconsciously doing something which art lost, you know, when in the terms of the Medici's and whatever, it was about propaganda primarily for the Catholic Church or whatever, or the Medici's. So that going right back to that tradition, these people that do that writing by using the same old board, repainting it, so they get what people like me would call a low paintly, high paintly build. Those things are carriers of propaganda. They're selling something. They have a function. The stuff that I do doesn't have a function. It's functionless. If it had a function, I wouldn't like it. So what they do all the things, all the method of high oil painting or high art. They have, you know, impasto. They have low paintly, high paintly build. They have scumbling where they drag that over the where they run out of paint and they thinner down a bit, and so they have glazing then. And so their intent, if I take them and put them in what I call the hallowed halls of the high institutes, it's like the body and blood of Jesus Christ, you know, like the wine becomes the blood and, you know, the bread becomes the body, so it transmutes into this other stuff, which I shovel over my shoulder. So I've lost my thread. I was listening. So what happens is, in my use of dedications, I use dedications on a lot of that work. So the only difference between me and those people is my intent is an art intent. Mm. Their intent is to sell something, sell a cucumber. Or
is this also a good time to go back to where you introduced language into your work with the frog poems?
The frog poem things, Rex has written about that a bit. But again, that's a reaction to things that happened within the so-called art setup. I'll just go back really quickly to my dedications to my proletarian friends that have no need for art. You know, I see it as an elitist activity. I want it to be elitist. If it were common, I wouldn't like it. I wouldn't want it. So that I bring them into the hallowed halls where they don't need to be, or they don't feel they're welcome, or they shouldn't be, by doing that. So I bring all those writers that do those things. If I could have found the signs, I would have installed them in the higher halls, but I can't find them. they're disappearing. So the only difference between those people and me is a matter of intent. My intent is to art them up or to bring them into the... And I know when I see them sitting out there going back to my earliest days of not thinking it was so such a presumption to paint a landscape, or that I know that in terms of manipulating the space and having it work within a space, that's going to knock hell out of this. That they go, if they work out there in the landscape, to bring them in here to the hallowed halls, they're going to work. They're going to say, "Hey, look, I'm something. You know, you may not like me, but I'm something. I'm sitting on the wall."
Let me ask one more question about one of the works on the show, and then we might let people here ask some questions. Can we show the Sabco brush? Because that's one that you do think knocks the hell out of the. It's one of your favourites, I know, from the show. This one here. What for people, were you actually trying to do here? I mean, what are you doing when you're sort of unravelling the paintbrush and using it to generate other works of art?
I've always sort of found certain sort of higher, you know, it fits my, I may not understand, I may not have, been on the, I'm certainly not going to what's the name, some sort of permutation and advance the hydrogen bomb or something like that. But my type of intellect, the art thing at its most complex fits my intellect. I can understand that. I can pull at the bits and where I can't do other stuff. It suits my intellect. So, you know, with colour theory, you know, I used to read, it's like School of Paris, the first of the books that I was sort of reading was School of Paris. And Gertie Langer got up to it, up to the same trick here. She would say, and they would say, but, you know, there's Manisia and Basia, there's people you wouldn't even know of who were School of Paris. They used to say, "Oh, but he's a wonderful colourist." But I used to think, is that enough? He's not much of an artist. So the thing of colour theory, I've found, you know, I agree with Picasso. I'm a bit more democratic than him, but he said that if you don't have one colour, use another. But I say, you know, if you don't have one colour, use another, and if it doesn't work, take it away and put another one there. So, you know, and I think for people that's sort of taking the paint from the tube and putting a bit in black and white with it and sullying it, you know, they're playing with mud pies as far as I'm concerned, you know. So I realised that there was a recipe in each of those brushes. So whether it's a quality thing or a brand, each different brand has a colour, certain colour permutation. So I realised that I was using the brush and that everything was there in the brush. It had a format, a certain rectangle, always 4 inch in my case, 4 inch brush. So it had a width, a format, and it had a colour code, which I could then, and I thought that that idea was so prime that when they were originally, I lost a dealer over them, in fact, who thought I was very arrogant. The ideal installation of those, I thought that the idea was so beautiful and so prime that that would structure the work and give the work presence. So they were originally painted to be installed one to a wall. And I would think that they, you know.
One paintbrush.
Yeah, that one panel. But there are a lot of them. There are a lot of them about the place. Some I still have. So I worked through that. So I further thought about that. So on the end of that, there's a perfect symmetry, because if you hold the brush, you have, a wooden handle, plastic now, but a wooden handle. You have a metal ferrule, which is a, and you have a hog's bristle brush. So when I hold the brush, I complete the symmetry as an artist, because you've got a mammal on either end of the brush. Me as a mammal. Metaphorically, you have the pig on the other end. So there's this circularity. So I, from those, I stopped doing those because I realised wherever I went in the world, I collected the brush brands which were have been installed, just a list of the brands. Then I realised that was superfluous, that they were already exhibited in the hardware stores. All you need to do if you want to have a look at them is go and they would, because I designated that as such.
This was done in 77.
Yes. Yeah.
And in 82 you did that wonderful text piece about I can see a can of paint as a painting unpainted.
Yes, yeah. So that's further thinking, the further thing that if you, another painter of my, an American painter of my watch, I'm just trying to think of his name, that said, you know, why, you know, contemporary with me, and, you know, there was no association there, but we just, when you've this thing of people copying and, you know, I believe all good art comes from previous art. And I'm highly eclectic and I make no excuses for it, you know. So he said that, you know, why would you open a tin of paint? Because the paint is there. Why would you sort of ruin that in some way by pulling it out of the and sullying that? So I came to the same conclusion where I exhibited with that text that I saw a can of paint as a painting unpainted. And then further to that, that it wasn't even necessary to have the paint in the what's name because the exterior of the can had a painted, in those days, a painted what's name, the brand instructions, all that stuff only. So I've really pushed that, you know, to see how far I could take that and yet still have that.
I was also interested in you saying that you really started the frog poems at the time of neo-expressionism.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, what happened in Australia and happened elsewhere, you know, there have been these movements, you know, that are sort of, you know, they pop up. So there's been a thing with the field in Australia, elsewhere. So my argument is that there were no field painters in Australia, no colour field painters that were following the dictum or the recipe, if you will, of Greenberg. You know, they came out of design or something like that, or it was a misinterpretation of it. So there was a thing called lyrical abstraction, which was again a thing, almost a falsely generated movement in America, which didn't last long, which was sort of a development. Funnily enough, colour field painting came out of abstract expressionism. So this other thing came out of abstract expressionism and was a sort of a bit of a kick against minimalism and whatever. So some Australian painters that have been in the field exhibition then became lyrical abstractionists. They loosened it up. So there was a thing. Some people believe that it was sort of commercial gallery driven, you know, the industry had to be kept kicking along. And that was a sort of new expressionism, which I, you know, came out of Germany largely, Italy to some extent. And I saw that as a return to easel painting, basically, as a return to the figure. So these same people that sort of hopped from the field to the failed to lyrical abstraction, from lyrical abstraction to figurative painting, the new expressionism, and then some of them died. They ran out of time, like me. So that this post-object thing, and I had, you know, I've had, don't read this as paranoia, but I've had an influence, a wide influence on younger artists and some artists of my what's name, you know, some admit their fathers, some don't. So I got a little bit tired of that. So when they were jumping on these bandwagons, I stopped painting and I did this thing, these frog poems, because I thought it was so dumb. I wasn't interested in frogs. I thought this was so dumb any of these sort of artists that misinterpret and they see me as the artist intellectual par excellence, some of them saw me as a working class hero, for God's sake. So I thought that no one would go in there after me. I could just winkle away.
For people who don't know, maybe you should mention that the text is Latin for the frogs.
Yeah, so again, it's sort of predicated on this thing that I see that art is just another language, like any other language, any other specialised language. So by using the Latin text for frogs in most cases, that to a herpetologist, he can look at that, and it doesn't matter whether he's a very sort of well-educated Eskimo or whether he's Russian or whatever, he can look at that. He knows that language, which is a dead language. He knows what that is. So that's his language. But I see that there's lots of other specialised languages. I've got a work which is in the National Gallery in Canberra now. It's a thing called White Angel. And when I was painting and docking, I was down there amongst those people, pretending I was one of them, but so they wouldn't throw me in the river.
Which people?
So a lot of those people were goomies.
Which people?
My proletarian associates. So there were a lot of those. You know, one thing about painting and docking, it's been demonised and deregistered in its form, like it was when I was there. But it was good because it would pick up people who were sort of absolute, I won't call them the dregs of humanity, they weren't. You know, they were associates. So a lot of those people were goomies. You know, they were on the metho or they were on all the sort of concoctions that you can watch them. So they had these wonderful metaphorical terms for... they changed to stop people from drinking metho. They put a blue dye in it. So they kept drinking. It was previous to that. It was called White Lady. They were on the White Lady. So they kept drinking it, but they changed the name. They changed the name to Blue Lady, and they kept drinking it. It's like certain economic terms that have been used since I was aware in the last 60 years or something, where they keep, it's still the same thing, but they just changed the name of it. You know, once it's a credit squeeze, or it's a mini budget, or it's a such and such, and they always dodge the D word, the depression, I don't want to say that. But so it's this thing of language. So where am I?
Would anyone like to ask a question of Bob about some of this work? I mean, I don't know if it's puzzled anyone, some of this stuff. You know, the thing that, well, we'll finish in a little while. I mean, one of the interesting things about this work, Bob, is that people do, in fact, you know, it seems like an arbitrary juxtaposition between a sort of species of frog and stuffed shoes with paper in them. People see this kind of metaphoric relation because I think this is a marsh frog or something, if I'm not, my memory serves me correctly, and stuffing shoes with paper is a way of fixing shoes that have been otherwise walking through marshes, right? And people always make this metaphoric connection in a way. You can't not make a connection between the language and the object.
But I've thrown it wide open to response. You know, there's multiple response and I can't control that. But, you know, if you're a pretty good art historian, you know that it comes directly from Le Tremont and, you know, I was think of the order of a sewing machine and whatever on a table, the juxtaposing of two sort of, two objects that have no connection and no obvious connection or whatever. So they're taken from that in a way, but there's always some, for those that know, that wants to get out their frog book and have a look, and like I did, because I'm not a herpetologist and I'm not interested in frogs, but there's some, no matter how sort of tenuous, there is a there is a sort of a correlation between those two things. But you just have to work a bit harder.
It was interesting that you're actually having a correspondence with Peter Tyndall about frogs at this time also.
Yeah, so what happened with There's been lots of these things go on in Australia, and the average punter doesn't need them, doesn't know about them, couldn't give a hoot about them. So there's been things called, you know, worldwide thing called mail art, where artists sent stuff to each other that sort of got into the hallowed halls in some ways. But and there's the book manifestation, you know, of artist books, these things. And I've been part of that movement as well. The work feeds over into lots of stuff. So Peter Tindall is a fellow artist and a friend, long-time friend. So Peter Tindall came to Brisbane in 1978 or something, and I kept him at a distance, but anyway, he weakened me. So when he flew up, it was the first time he'd ever flown on a plane. So he's very game, Peter, gentle but game. So when he flew, he got a flyer's helmet, a World War II flyer's leather helmet and Glotz name. And he had his partner photograph him, and he put out this thing, you know, a souvenir of the first flight and all that stuff. So where I was working then, up the top of the town, I had to park my car and walk down. So I collected the most, the dirtiest pigeon feathers that I could find, and I put them on a long string, and I put them in a box that my wife, partner then, but wife later, had an American airmail box that had a letter with wings on it or something. So I put a hole in the top of this, the lid of this box, put the string and tied knot. So when you open it, these things fell out and they went like that. So from that time on, then Peter kept sending me stuff and I sent him stuff. So the frog thing came from an American scientific magazine illustration of the development of the frog from the spawn to the final frog. So what I did, I made up a series of cards which I sent out, but I reversed the order, and it was cubism, another aspect, because I always thought that there were better solutions to cubism than the one Picasso and Braque took. So I reversed the order, so I sent out the complete frog, the fully developed frog, one day, and then backwards, so that, you know, if you look at a frog, most punters don't think of all the other sort of images that are involved in that. So he then started sending me frog stuff, cards, anything relative to frogs, which continues to this day. In fact, I kept the Dalesford or Hepburn Springs post, I'm very proud of this, post office. When I'm just trying to think of his name, he was the guy that was the premier of Kennett. Yes, he was closing. They were closing post offices, so that was like a little licensed post office. So wasn't my intent, but one year I sent 3,000. What's name? So, and it was based on. The flow of the number of items that went through the post offices. So that year that actually saved the post office. So I got this wonderful what's name from the people who own the post office. So there's so much, and look, it's been a long ride and it continues on and it's been fun.
Does anyone have any questions? We would ask you to wait for the mic.
Maybe we should all go and have a drink, but
I don't need anyone, it's sort of...
Can I just say something? You mentioned
Can we use the mic? For the film.
You mentioned two Australian artists that were influences on you, Godfrey Miller, but we didn't get to hear the other person.
Probably Fulbrook, maybe. That was friendly with Fulbrook, and I think that Fulbrook was a pop artist before there were pop artists. He took from, you know, for those that knew the clues. I mean, he had that, which came a convention. He took Banks's Ginger Meg's, like the two dots and the smear. He painted, you know, one of the earlier things of I can't say Lubra, can I? A black female, Aboriginal female. Can I say any of those things? One of them. Mother and child. And what it was, because, again, I could see that stuff being a sticky pick, it was a copy from the label of a Tonkala condensed milk tin or evaporated milk tin. So he'd always done stuff like that, Sam. And he was great. It's a great, you know, there are sort of tonal painters and bugger it up painters. So Sam was, his tone's always crisp. And, you know, he's a great tonal painter, or he was. And he'd also been up at poking his nose into the Queensland Library as well, because he'd had a good look at a fellow called Milton Avery, an American painter. Mm-hmm. And Sam, at his best, surpasses Milton Avery. And I knew Sam, old drunk, but he was likeable. So,
any other questions?
Well, it's always very interesting for an art critic to listen to an artist and all the sort of plethora of issues and things that go into these works. And in Rob's case, they're so cerebral seeming, and yet when you get him talking, there's these incredibly long autobiographical aspects to it, which is really fascinating. And you're always far too aware, listening to artists when you meet them, that when you try and say something about them as an art critic, how little you can capture of the work in a few number of words, you know. And that's always why it's so fascinating to listen to artists, because they have so many other things that no critic could ever sort of write down and make sense of in an art show. So, you know, it's a really rare occasion to listen to Robert, who's been around for a long time and is not simply a prominent Queensland artist, but a very different kind of Queensland artist. And it shakes up the story to imagine someone making this kind of art.
See, I dismiss that. Yeah. I dismiss that thing of Queensland artist.
Oh, absolutely. We'll get to that.
Or as a national artist, or as an international artist. Yes. I aim much higher than absolutely. That. I think there's a universal measure out there, aesthetics, whatever you want to call it. That's where I want to belong. And it's, say, the Queensland series, Pam Bell, who... Nancy's no longer there. So... who Nancy would know, and someone here might know, but Pam Bell, Pam and I liked each other. So Pam had won, for all her what's name, she was horsey, she won the Gold Cup in cam drafting, I think, for females. Nancy was also a rider. So Pam had been, she used to try to stir me a bit. So she'd been to Sydney or Melbourne, Sydney, I presume, on some selection committee. I've never been able to find out, for a show that went overseas. So Nancy Borlase, who was the wife of Watson Laurie Short, who was a very anti-communist within the unions, one of Santa Maria's protégés. Just trying to recover this now. So anyway, what happened was that Pam proposed my work for this what's name. So Pam came back and said to me, I proposed your work for that show and Nancy Borlase knocked it. She said that you're not of national significance. And I said to Pam, well, I'm not. I don't consider myself to be of national significance. You know, so when you see Nancy next time, just tell her that, you know, thank her for that. That's wonderful to say that I wasn't national. So I did these Queensland things, which was the thing you see, that geometricized sort of, which, so I just went, that was early days of the IMA, so all the things that I was involved in, you know, where the object ends and the wall begins and how the object works under the wall and how it affects 60s jargon, how it affects felt space and all that. So I just did that series, and it's titled, Is National Art a Simplistic View? And I punctuated, I can't think how now, in such a way where I wasn't saying it shouldn't have got up anyone's nose, because I wasn't saying, in inverted commas, and when this is a firm statement of fact, you know, that national art is a simplistic view. You could read whatever you liked into it. But I did, so some of those things there, you know, in, like the one on this end, you would think that delineates an area of wall, but what it does, it actually has a white background within that reserve. The other one further down, that white that's coming through there, I think is probably wall. So there's all the possible permutations of that, of how that works on the wall. And
if you just want to show the Frank Stella, because that's kind of, I think,
it's 1978.
Yeah, it's a bit like, yeah. I mean, it's got some relation to that, hasn't it, Bob? Yeah.
Well, I don't, but the fact is, the only relationship is that it is a thing. It's a thing.
Art critics aren't doing well this evening. We'll always fight back. We'll get the final word, I promise you. Always get the final word.
Well, maybe that should be the final word.
Yes. Well, thank you for joining us, everyone, yes, and it's a rare occasion.
Yeah, thank you.